Gloves off is always on point.
On point.
Bringing you the best on current issues, community affairs, and the happenings around us. This segment of Gloves Off is brought to you by the best, so pay them a visit. Check them out. This is Gloves Off. If you've ever wondered, if you ever had a clue what would happen if Batman, the Avengers, the X-Men fought the 47 Ronin, you will have great hitting, power strikes, and speed. This event will be known as the North Texas Stick Fighting Championships. It's open to all martial artists. This is where legends are formed, where they're forged, where they are founded. Sign up now. Call the number 956-401-4868 and look up the website at www.savate.biz. So remember, this is for serious martial artists. If you're not serious, sit back and whisper about the event. If not, we'll see you there.
Gloves Off, and today's a special show. It's our 300 edition, and I have with me a woman that's a leader in our community, a great friend, a great judge, the Honorable Becky Paloma.
No, I'm good. Thank you, Paul. Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Have you been?
I'm good. Good. Busy. Like you. Busy, but I appreciate you inviting me. I'm here. I want the community to know, you know, what's going on in the courts and what's going on here in our community. It's very important, and I'm glad you have this platform available.
No, and it was an accident how we started it, and it's good because people get to know people.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
You know, not only just, oh, she's a judge or he's a commissioner or whatnot. People get to know what they're actually talking about because sometimes they're misunderstood.
Right, I agree.
I wanted to ask you one simple question.
Yes.
What did you say when they told you, would you like to run, or was it something that came out of you?
It's something that came out of me. I started my legal career when I was 26 years old after graduating from St. Mary's Law School. This was in 1998. I was a young prosecutor at the district attorney's office. I eventually made my way up to a felony prosecutor position, and I was assigned to the 341st District Court, where my predecessor, Judge Elma Salinas Sender, which is the bench I'm at now. And I loved my job, and I remember seeing the judge, and, you know, I had one of those moments where, wow, that's awesome. Like, maybe one of these days, you know, dreaming, one of these days. So shortly after that, I was very fortunate to have been appointed by the district judges to be the director of the Adult Probation Department. And so I was still within the criminal justice system as the director of the probation department. And while I was there in that department, 6 years later, Judge Ender announced her retirement. Sure. And you know, it just, there was a spark, and it's like, okay, there's opportunities. I know that there's opportunities, and they're not just there lingering, waiting for you to make a decision. They're just passing by. And so I said, okay, I'm going to take this opportunity, and hopefully, you know, we accomplish the goal. And if we don't, then it's going to be fun. It's going to be a fun experience. And so I'm glad I'm on the bench.
And that's what, 7 years now?
7 years. Yes. 7 years, a lot of work, Paul. The 341st is a court of general jurisdiction, so I handle family law cases, which are complex, very emotional and draining, civil cases, which are also very complex, and criminal cases, which are tough.
Out of all your cases that you've had, can you go one, not mentioning it, but just can you go one that said, you know what, I did not know what I was getting into. Look at what's going on here.
I've had so many cases and so many trials. There's two in particular, because that's the number one question I get at the schools when I talk to the students.
Sure.
That's the number one question. And I could tell you without details or names or anything about two different types of cases that weighed heavily on me. And one of them was, I was sworn in January 1st, 2013. February was my first trial, criminal trial, as a judge. Young man, 19-year-old, and the jury finds him guilty for murder and sentences him to 60 years in prison. And it was under the law of parties, the concept of the law of parties in Texas. And so I talked to the students about this one case, because this young man made a decision to be with other young men that had a gun, that had an issue with someone else, and it was really a situation that got out of hand. And he was there, and the other two individuals got lost, were never prosecuted because they haven't been found. And the one that never touched the gun, the one that didn't know the victim, had no issues with the victim, is the one that's in prison for 60 years. And to see a young man's future completely destroyed because of a stupid mistake, a stupid decision of knowing, you know, I'm not gonna hang out with those guys because they're bad news. And that's the message that I give these students at school. The other case that weighs very heavy on my heart is in the family law cases. And I'm a mother, you know,
sure.
Paul, you've met my boys. I'm a mother of five boys.
They're great lads, and I remember them, they're this big now.
Now they're taller than you and I, yes. And I know, you're a parent. I know it's not easy to be parents. It's a struggle and it's a challenge, and we have to work at it all the time. We have to make it a priority, right? And there's people in our community that don't make that struggle a priority, that don't make the children a priority. And I've had to terminate parental rights. And one case in particular where this woman really, really had tried. She voluntarily took parenting classes. She had two jobs. She had her own apartment. She stayed away from men. She was really trying to convince me and to show me to reverse the former court's decision to terminate her rights. unfortunately, everything she had already done had caused so much damage to the children, and as a judge, I'm mandated by the family code to make the findings in the best interest of the children, and at that point, it was in the best interest of the children to terminate her parental rights, and it's not an easy decision to make.
Yeah, of course not, and we have parents, we're learning, mm-hmm. you know. One thing that I see, because we see a lot of parents here,
mm-hmm.
and is the ones that, the kids when they come in, the ones that you extend their hand and they'll shake your hand and they're looking at you,
mm-hmm.
you know they have good parents.
Mm-hmm. Right.
The kids that come in and they're looking around, they don't even shake your hand
right.
and stuff, you're like, you know,
mm-hmm.
there's something there.
Right.
And you can tell right away. So we as parents and those listening, we have to put our foot down. You know, I tell my kids, I'm not your friend, I'm your father.
Right.
I'm more than that.
Right.
Okay? And I'm also gonna be stern with you.
Right.
Okay? And those parents that think that, oh, he's my buddy, he's my friend, they're gonna get in trouble.
Right.
You know,
right.
there's a society gap, there's an alpha beta system.
Right.
Unfortunately, that's what we are.
Right.
You know? And they're gonna step up on you,
mm-hmm.
and they're gonna step over you and control you, and they can control you at a small age, and if they're doing that 4 or 5 years old, believe me, they're gonna do it at 15, 16.
Absolutely, I agree with you 100%, and it's incumbent on us parents and as a community to, when I was a kid, I remember seeing other men correct young men. And you don't see that now.
No.
Because someone will take offense and tell you, don't talk to my kid. But I'm trying to correct your son. No, I'll correct my son. And so we as a community should be able to help each other out. As the saying goes, you know, it takes a village to raise a child.
And with that in mind, that's an excellent phrase that's used, you know. Takes a village, a group,
mm-hmm.
and create a child. And
mm-hmm.
it's true, to raise them.
Mm-hmm.
You have to, everybody. And if we do not understand that, we do that right now anyway. Because we send them off to school. Where they get educated in school. We don't have our children 24/7.
Right.
You know, at 7 o'clock in the morning, our child is going for 9 hours somewhere
mm-hmm.
else.
Mm-hmm.
And he's going to be taught and disciplined somewhere else.
And influenced. And
exactly right.
Mm-hmm.
And influenced. And that continues on.
Right.
As soon as they're 5 years old onward,
mm-hmm.
society is already influencing our child.
Right.
So when we get them at home, we have to be very vigilant of what they're on.
Right, absolutely. And that's my advice to the parents when I go into the events that I'm very fortunate to be invited to. Students that are receiving scholarships, the ones that I applaud before applying the students, congratulating the students, are the parents. And I ask them to rise, and I ask everyone in the room to applaud them because they're doing something right. If their child is there receiving a recognition and a scholarship for college, then the parents are doing something right. And after I do that, I tell them, let me tell you why I do this. I'm on the bench, and I'm a judge that handles criminal cases. And for you know, I have most of my cases, 65% of my cases are all criminal.
Mm-hmm.
And I see the other side of the parents in here. I see the parents that aren't paying attention, that aren't disciplining their children, that aren't 100% invested in raising good kids, because I see the young adults in the courtroom. And you asked me what case, you were very specific in your question, Paul, earlier. You said what case, you know, has been difficult, and I gave you two examples. But what's also been very hard, it's not one case in particular, it's just a whole group of cases in my criminal docket of young men and a lot of young women that are caught up in a revolving door within the criminal justice system because they're addicted to drugs. And I ask all of them the same questions. How old are you? How old were you when you first started using drugs? What drug did you start using? How did you escalate to this? What do you want to do with your life? And unfortunately, the good majority of them say, I started smoking weed. You know, my cousin, my uncle, it's usually a family member, a close friend.
You're absolutely correct. You're absolutely correct. I've had many young men and women come in here. Now, my my classes are younger kids, you know, because we're in older in the 30s, right? But for a long time, it was 17 to 30.
Mm-hmm.
That bracket was for a very long time. That's what I was attracted to Savant, right?
Mm-hmm.
But what I used to see is the ones who used to come in here, and you can tell right away who are the ones that don't smoke weed.
Right.
And right away, they'll come up with the excuses with this and so on and so, so forth. That 20 years ago, you see them now, they're still with that same excuses and so on and so forth,
mm-hmm.
okay? And there's a lot of people, and drugs do not discriminate.
They do not discriminate. Mm-hmm.
You know, it hits professionals,
mm-hmm.
it hits laymen, it hits people that have no work, it hits everybody just across the board.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't care whether you're Jew or
nope.
a Christian or
nope.
Muslim, it's just going to get it's gonna get you.
Doesn't care if you're 14 or 33.
It's going to get you.
Mm-hmm.
And you're right, it starts with the family member. I've had, now that, you know, thinking back, I've had several kids that the moms leave them with the uncle.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know that the uncle went
right.
to school with you, and the uncle was a pothead, a smoker back then. He's still now.
Right.
And the kid comes in here, 15 years old, giggling with that little grin, smelling like marijuana. And then all of a sudden, the mom says, well, I didn't know he was in that. I didn't
really weren't paying attention.
Who are you dropping him off with?
Right.
If your brother's a pothead, more likely you're, and he's the one that you're leaving your kid with, more likely your kid's going to
mm-hmm.
end up being a pothead as
mm-hmm.
well. That's just the way it is. And I know that there's a lot of liberals that want marijuana to be
mm-hmm.
legalized. Fine and dandy. You know, there's a state, Colorado. If
right.
you want to go do that, move to Colorado.
Right.
But here in Texas right now, it's illegal.
Right.
And then it's illegal.
And that's it.
That's it. So
right.
if I could care less about the medical, and if
medicinal,
it is,
right.
if it's fine, then you get a prescription and you get one from the pharmacy.
Right.
There's no issue with that.
Right.
I have no quarrels with them to say, you know what, it clears glaucoma, it clears whatever.
Right.
Unless you have a prescription from the doctor and there's a medicine that's already fabricated out of it, I have no quarrel with
mm-hmm.
it.
The interesting thing, it's not surprising, but it's interesting because it's across the board, Paul.
Sure.
When I ask these questions, they tell me they started smoking marijuana.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, and then they graduated to another drug, a stronger drug, and they thought that, you know, marijuana didn't control me, but I didn't understand that heroin was going to destroy me
exactly.
the very first time I used it. And so I have hundreds of cases. All of us district judges are dealing with this very serious problem here in our community, and it's happening across our nation, of individuals addicted to heroin. Thank God here in Laredo in South Texas, we don't.
It has not hit us hard.
It hasn't hit us hard. We're dealing with a serious problem, but we haven't dealt with methamphetamine, which is other parts of Texas, in East Texas, Northeast Texas, are dealing very, very horrible with it. But I'm very proud to partner with Judge Oscar Hale, and we
sure.
have the drug court program, we have the Veterans Treatment Program, because we do understand that once individuals are addicted to this drug, they can't get off of it on their own.
No, you're absolutely correct. And there's a lot of bad drugs out there. There's Flaca, there's Crocodilia that'll eat you alive, and
mm-hmm.
there's drugs that are being passed on in other communities
mm-hmm.
that people they're not aware of, and it'll come and get you.
Mm-hmm.
Here, where heroin has not hit as hard.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's here, though.
It's here.
But, you know, that's where I have kind of a confusing ideology. We're if you get somebody that's hooked on drugs,
mm-hmm.
let's help them.
Right.
I'm with that.
Okay.
I understand. But if we catch somebody that's pushing these drugs,
prosecute them.
To the full extent of law.
Right.
And if there has to be, because you're destroying not one life, you're destroying 20
right.
lives.
Right.
And if you have to go into the extreme of execution, let it happen. Because
right.
I believe that's the only way you're going to get people to say, oops, you know what? He just got executed for selling heroin.
That happens in other countries.
You know what
in
I'm
Asia,
saying? And,
right.
oh, you know what? I'm not going to go do that.
That happens in other countries where you steal something, they cut your fingers off, you
yes,
steal
sure.
it again, they cut your arm off, and, you know, you sell drugs, you're executed. That's not going to happen here in the United States, even in conservative
soon.
Texas, even in conservative Texas. But the distinction we draw, and it's very obvious, is if if you're violent and you're aggressive and you're a threat to this community, then you need to be behind bars.
Of course.
And you need to be punished, okay? If you're committing crimes, if you're a good person and you're committing crimes because you're addicted to drugs, then let's help this person so that we can get him back on his feet. Unfortunately, what we see, Paul, are a bunch of young men. I just got back from San Francisco. I'm a member of the American Probation and Parole Association. I participate and now I'm going to start leading judicial roundtable discussions with other judges from other states so that we can share what on the same topics, for example, human trafficking, immigration, bond reform, criminal reform, marijuana legalization. We talk about all of that and everybody gets to share what's happening in their state, how they're resolving different issues pertaining to each topic. What we see is drug courts are highly successful. They're wonderful programs, but what we're learning is how do you rehabilitate someone that has never been habilitated, someone that's never
had a good idea what good is,
never been raised by parents that teach you manners, that teach you respect, that teach you how to look for a job, that teach you how to communicate with someone at an interview, to, you know, that tell you, you know, how important education is. We have young men that don't even know how to go, you know, where do I go get a driver's license?
You're absolutely correct. We've there's generations now, gaps
mm-hmm.
now.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there's plenty of generations that were brought up by a single parent,
mm-hmm.
regardless whether it was a man or woman. Literally, the babysitter was the one that, or some after-school program was the one that took care of him,
mm-hmm.
okay? Or basically, the playground was the one that taught him.
Mm-hmm.
Understand what I'm saying?
Yes,
so,
yes.
And
yes,
they
yes.
grew up like this. And so you have parents that all of a sudden, they come in, they don't know how to deal with their child because they were raised like this. So they take little Billy, little Sally to the doctor and say, you know what, doctor? I cannot control my child. She doesn't want to eat. She doesn't want to do the homework. Well, you know what? I can prescribe this for her.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, you just started her off even though it's prescription,
mm-hmm.
medication.
Still.
You just started her off on the road to drugs.
Because
mm-hmm. at 5, 6, 8 years old, some of these kids are in La La Land when you see them. And there's no need to them. It's called parent. We need to start
mm-hmm.
rearing our kids.
Right.
And not allowing somebody else to say, you know what? Just give her this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, take care of her.
Right. It's very unfortunate.
And that's very unfortunate. And that goes on across the board.
It's
so many kids that we have here in Laredo that are already on a medication, drug,
right.
walking into school.
Right.
And there was no need for them to be there.
Mm-hmm.
But, oh, they got HD.
Sick, overprescribed. Mm-hmm.
And guess what? He goes up, and all of a sudden he already started. So marijuana to him is not going to be
right.
in the flow.
Right.
So he's already popping pills. At 13, he's going to get his mom's. And guess what?
Mm-hmm.
You have a problem.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we have to kind of control that gap.
And it starts at home. It starts at home. It's difficult.
Absolutely.
It's difficult from a judge's perspective. You know, we can have all these programs. And you know, you asked me, what are the most serious cases you've seen? And the flip side to that is, you know, what are the best things I've seen on the bench as a judge? And something that I've seen in the drug court, in these cases that we handle, is hope in individuals that despite living a cycle, a generational cycle of abuse and drugs and dysfunction, they want to change. They see someone that is giving them direction, giving them instruction, is applauding every tiny little effort they make to do good. And you see them transform. At the very beginning, you see how you see the kids come in here. They don't look at you, they don't care, they have attitude. That's how they are in court. Young men, young women, I mean, and they even look different. And then once we get them sober, we help them get a job, they're doing community service hours, so they feel they're paying back to society for making the mistakes that had legal consequences. you see them start changing. You see them with some level of respect and dignity. You see them, you see more importantly, you see a little light of hope for
right.
them. That, okay, he's going to be good. And if he's good, if she's good, then there's a chance for the children that are coming from this individual. And that cycle, that family dysfunctional cycle, will not continue. I'm very fortunate to also conduct Courts and Schools program. I go into the schools, Paul, and I've been doing this from the first month I got on the bench 7 years ago. I go into the middle schools, into the high schools, and the entire court system staff, with defense attorneys, prosecutors, clerks, staff, my bailiffs, everybody, we all go. We set up in the high school auditorium or gymnasium. We have 200, 400 students. And they get to see me sentence 5 or 6 individuals on a given morning. And they get to see what type of decisions lead to criminal legal consequences. sending nude photos in a text, or bullying someone on social media, having weed in your backpack. Or going on a ride with other guys that you really don't know, and they're really not your friends, but you chose to get in a car with them. All those things have legal consequences, can have legal consequences, and they start with, and this is the emphasis that I make to the students, it starts with your decision. You're in control, and you need to stop, make a decision, and say, okay, if I get in that car, if I put this in my backpack, if I press send on this picture in social media, what's going to happen? What are the consequences? You need to consider all the alternatives.
You're absolutely correct.
That's what you need to do.
And people do, you know, it's so easy, the technology we've got, right? But let's just take the technology out. Let's take the decision making. You know, that I was asked one time, and it was told, "Boy, Prophet, but I'm going to lose my friends." Young lad, about 16 years.
And when you're that age, you really care. Like, it's your friends or your whole world.
And I said, what do they want you to do? No, they want us to go to this party that's going to be over here, does this, and I really don't feel like going. If you don't feel that you're going, that you don't want to go, then, you know, if you feel, you know what, I don't want to go there, don't go.
Right. Don't.
Period. Listen, if you feel you don't want to hang around with that person,
don't.
And you don't return the text, and they're not going to hang around with you, don't. Okay. Because all they want is get you into trouble. Somewhere along the line, they want an excuse.
Mm-hmm.
And believe me, they're going to point the finger at you a lot faster than wave at you.
My mom growing up, Paul, my mom, because when you're that age, in middle school, you think you know it all, number one.
Sure.
Your friends and wanting to fit in is all time important.
Exactly.
And you know, you're very vulnerable during that stage in life. You don't really value the advice your elders give you. I remember my mom would tell me, "Mijita, para cuando tú vas, yo ya fui y vine. Tú a mí no me vas a decir." And so that kept me, you know, that kept me in line. And I'm not comparing it to the decisions these kids are making, but just simple stuff like, I want to go spend the night at my friends. We're just, you know, we're going to stay up late and, you know, talk about boys. And my mom, no, esta es tu casa, aquí te duermes, and that's it, you know. And now that I'm older, I'm so thankful, and I value and I appreciate the fact that my parents have always been loving and supportive and very, very present.
Absolutely. You know, I told one of my kids the other day, I said, you know what? I trust you.
I don't trust them.
I don't trust them.
Right.
And it's not your friend immediately, but it's his friend, since his friend, that usually gets everybody in trouble.
Right.
I'm going to invite my friend, and he's going to write to these other friends. You don't know who they are.
Right.
What happens if you're in a car and all of a sudden they're smoking pot? Guess what? All of you
right.
are going down with a ticket.
Right.
Okay? And they'll say, you did it as well. Believe me.
It's true.
And I said, you know, and I tell them, no, it's enough. Enough's enough. Here, it stops.
And that's the, you know, that's already when we're talking about behavior that has criminal consequences.
Sure.
But if we as a society can address just simple issues, for example, I told you that last night we were at a football game. Some kids behind us were being rowdy, but they were being kids, you know, they were being boys. And, you know, we were still focusing on the game, but there was this one kid that while they were all laughing, he kept using a very vulgar word, one word, very vulgar. And for the most part, everything else he said was okay, but that one vulgar word, he kept repeating it, and all the other boys would continue just laughing and continue talking. And my husband heard it, I heard it, we kept turning and giving him, you know, an ugly look, like, there's children, there's women around you, like, watch your mouth. And it continued. And I told my husband, either you go or I'm gonna go. And he's like, okay, I'll go. And my husband went up there and said, son, I mean, because he said, well, where's the father? He said, you're not gonna go be his father. You know, just please ask him to stop. You're not gonna scold him, mm-hmm. just gonna, and my husband went last night and he told him, son, you can't talk like that. You're in a public setting, and young boys, all of you all that are laughing at him, and don't tell your friend to stop talking and acting like this. You're condoning it, and all of you all look bad.
Yeah, absolutely. And we as parents have to teach them that. We as parents also have to teach them, you know what, when no is no.
That's it. Aunque brinques y saltes y te
no,
no,
no
es no. No me vas a convencer.
That's it.
Right.
That's it.
Right.
No is no.
Right.
You know?
Right.
There's a reason why it says no. There's a reason why there's a circle with a thing that says no.
That's it.
You better understand that.
Right.
Okay.
Right. I think the biggest mistake that parents make and that we make when we allow our kids, when we don't enforce our own rules, or we say something at our home, if I say, you better be here at a certain time, and if not, you're not gonna go out for a month, that I need to enforce that. I need to follow through, because if I don't, then they're gonna know that I'm not serious.
They can get the leeway.
They can get the leeway. And so there's, you're programming an individual, a young individual that's gonna become an adult and that's gonna go out into this world thinking that they can bend the rules, that they can get away with a little bit, and that, you know, that the rules sometimes are not enforced. And that's not what we want for our children. That's not what we want for our society.
Absolutely. You know, and that has to start at home. And
mm-hmm.
that's right. If you're going to give a punishment, follow through with the punishment.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay? And I'm not talking about you spanking your kids and being...
Right.
You be stern with the punishment that you give.
Right, right.
And follow through with it. No video games for the next day.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure. Not in 2 hours he's playing video games. Oh, it's okay.
Mm-hmm.
Or parents that live together, mom and dad, and the father says, you can't go out.
Right.
And the father leaves to work, and the mom says, no, you can go ahead and go.
No. Mm-hmm.
You
mm-hmm.
have to follow
right.
each one.
Right.
Because once you start breaking that, then it's...
I commend single parents.
Sure.
I commend single parents. I know a lot of women that are single. I know
men
that
are
single parents.
Yeah.
And
sure.
I applaud them and for all of their efforts, because Danny and I, my husband Danny, we're a team, and we stick together, and if he says something, then I back him up, and vice versa, and we work together, and we talk about, you know, the virtues and values that we're instilling in our boys, and we're being intentional. It's not haphazard. It's intentional, the values that we are exampling to our children, to build that character and develop them into young, responsible men.
You're absolutely correct. And I see that, you know, and you know that I got divorced several years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And my ex and I have a relationship. It's the same.
Mm-hmm.
We're still parents of our children. Okay? And a lot of people say, where's the father? Where's the father? Wait a minute. I'm my father. We're two separate things, but the father's still
right.
present. Understand?
Right.
And we can't allow this separation of fathers, because there's a lot of women that get divorced
mm-hmm.
and they exclude the father, alienate the father
mm-hmm.
whatsoever.
Mm-hmm.
And our community says,
mm-hmm.
you know what, we need more fathers out there.
Mm-hmm.
You can't exclude them. We have to bring the fathers
right.
back.
I remind the couples getting divorced at the 341st there's many of them that are very mature in the process that they're experiencing, because any divorce is very difficult. Sure. And but you could see that both of them are on the same page. They're putting their children first, despite whatever's happening between them. They are communicating amicably, and they're getting the divorce amicably, and they're putting the children first. You see the flip side of that,
sure,
where the parents are using the kids as pawns, and it's very obvious, and it's dysfunctional, it's bad, and it's not in the children's best interest. So I make it a point to talk to those parents and to tell them, you can't do that. I order them, you cannot. I don't want you talking to the kids about the other parents in derogatory terms. I don't even want you to talk to them. I'm going to court, you get a judge, you get this, you get your dad wants to take this away from me, and your mom wants to do this to me. The kids that's none of their business. You don't need to pollute their minds and their emotions and hurt them with this. And so I tell the parents, y'all are getting divorced. Focus on your children, get divorced, divide whatever you need to do. And you know, if you can't make it work, primarily I wish y'all could make it work, but I understand situations, you know, some people
you
are better apart, and that's it.
You can't, you know, and every agreement sometimes has to end.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry, you know, and
but when children are involved,
you have that's them first,
right? You always, and you see the difference between very open-minded, mature adults going through a painful experience that can put themselves second and put their children first, and then you see the very selfish parents. Unfortunately, there's many out there, very selfish parents
that
pit their children against the other and that are using their children as pawns, and it's disgusting.
And you see, I've had many kids, and I've known many, many families and friends that all of a sudden they're not allowed, the fathers aren't allowed to see the child. And the child grows up thinking, oh, my dad doesn't love me, this doesn't love me. Then they find out later on that it wasn't that.
Right.
And then all of a sudden you see the flip side, and they turn on the other parent.
Right.
And the other parent's like, oh, he took her away from me, or he took him away from me. No, you took him away from me.
I've seen it from both sides. Yes. I've seen it from both sides. And my advice to the parents where I see that happening, I remind them that research, it's not just me, the judge said, no. Research shows that as it is, children struggle to grow up and to develop and have a healthy self-esteem.
As it is,
even with both healthy parents, a strong marriage, as it is, we still, in this society, right? So research shows that that child has a better chance of developing well if both parents, whether they're separated, have a good communication and show that the child comes first. And so I can't emphasize that more.
No, and I get it. And you know, I remember about a month ago, before I got because I get them in July,
mm-hmm,
right, for summer vacation.
You get them the whole month?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then she called in and she said, you know, he can't pay me this much because I punished him for this week, so it's going to go into your week. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You're coming here. Guess what? See this?
Yes.
Right here,
yeah.
Continuing.
Good. Oh, good.
And then they're like, oh, that's the end of the story.
Mm-hmm. That's it. And the kids learn.
Yeah.
They learn. Like before, they would, you know, they'd ask their dad something. My boy said, Dad, can I do this? And Dad would say no.
And then
they come, Mom, please. And Dad said that if you say yes, and I'm like, let me talk to Dad. And I'm like, Dad's like, no, I said no. And I'm like, no. And then they stop doing that because they know it's not going to work, right? I love being a mom. I really enjoy being a mom. It's the hardest job in the world. Even though I've had very stressful positions, very difficult jobs, but they're professional. You know, I dedicate myself. I'm responsible. I work hard. But my job, because that's what it is as a mom, is 100% invested. It's every second of every minute of every hour.
Absolutely.
Of every day.
And it's
going
to continue that way.
Yes. My son called me last week, my 15-year-old Marcelo. He's a sophomore at Alexander. He called me. I missed his call. I was busy. I called him back at about an hour later. And I'm like, hey, Papa, you needed something? Hey, Papa, you called me. He's like, oh, Mom, I don't need you anymore. Because I don't know what he needed. He's like, oh, mama, I don't need you anymore. And I'm like, baby, you're going to need me the rest of your life. You just don't know it yet. And he chuckled, and he's like, you're right, mom. But I needed something. Dad already signed it. He needed something for school. Dad already signed it. So, okay, baby.
That's the way it is. Absolutely correct.
And it pains me to see that there's a lot of young men and young women growing here in our community, aquí en Laredo, probably in our neighborhoods, that don't have family dinners, that don't, you know, get a good night kiss at night, that don't sit down and talk about life and about future and about goals and aspirations and about family history and how they resolved problems before and how to address issues within the family. Unfortunately, those individuals that aren't being habilitated have a hard time through the criminal justice system when they end up there. It's very hard, Paul.
You're absolutely correct. And here's the last one. When all this is over, because one day you're going to get off the bench and you're going to pass the gavel to somebody else and you're going to say, here.
Mm-hmm.
What would you like to do with that court towards the community that will impact it the best?
Continue doing what I'm doing. I'm involved with a lot of different local organizations, as you know, and I'm very fortunate, as I mentioned, to be a member of the American Probation and Parole, where I learn what other judges are doing in other states. I'm also a member of the National Association of Women Judges. Through that association, I learned about the Color of Justice program. The next month, I came to Laredo. I came back to Laredo, and I said, "Okay, I'm going to do this program that I learned from being a member of this association, and it's called the Color of Justice program." And the first year, I invited 40 young women to the Justice Center to learn about the law, to learn about becoming a judge. So the Color of Justice program, the mission is to educate, encourage, and inspire minority students to pursue a career in the law. In my family, when I decided to go to law school, the only perception I had was what I saw on TV. My family, you know, I didn't have attorneys in my family. My family didn't know attorneys that they could take me here. Me, you know, mijita wants to ask you a bunch of questions. And so that's all I had. And I want to expose these opportunities to be a lawyer, to be a judge, to other students that may not know a judge or may not know an attorney. And so this past year was, then in May, was the fifth year of the Color of Justice program. It's grown to 250 students, young men and young women from all the high schools, including Bruni and Zapata, come to the Justice Center. I pair them up with different legal professionals, with different attorneys, different judges. They get to shadow all day, and then we give them an award at the end of the day, and it's a very successful program. And I've been very fortunate to be on the bench and to have this opportunity to do these things. And when eventually, like you said, when I pass the gavel on, I want to know that I made a difference in one person's life.
That's the way it is.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way it is. And number one, we're glad to have you.
Thank you, Paul.
We're
Thank
glad
you.
To have you in there, and we're leading the way.
Thank you.
And you have to. And I know it's very hard when the gavel sounds. Sometimes it's for the best, but it's always for the best of the side.
Right.
Right.
They're different. There's, you know, they're difficult decisions, but the community elected me to make those decisions. And
Absolutely.
so right. And while I'm a judge, I don't judge people, I judge their actions according to what the law says. And that helps me process some of the pain that I see in the courtroom.
Absolutely. Well, we want to thank you, and I know the community thanks you.
Thank you, Paul.
No, thank you. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Folks, until next time, peace.
Thank you.
For 30 years, Buitron Academy has produced great fighters, peace officers, firemen, and many great citizens of Laredo. We teach various martial arts. Savat. Kempo. Capoeira. Each in their own traditions, trajectory, history, and pedagogy. Buitron Academy is the first school of Savant in the United States, the first Capoeira movement in Texas, the first Kempo school in Laredo. What will one expect to see at Buitron Academy? Respect. Fellowship. Coordination. Skill. And self-defense. Buitron Academy is located at 220 West Hillside Road.
If you ever had a clue what would happen if Batman, the Avengers, the X-Men fought the 47 Ronin, you will have great hitting, power strikes, and speed. This event will be known as the North Texas Stick Fighting Championships. It's open to all martial artists. This is where legends are formed, where they're forged, where they are founded. Sign up now. Call the number 956-401-4868 and look up the website at www.savate.biz. So remember, this is for serious martial artists. If you're not serious, sit back and whisper about the event. If not, we'll see you there. Gloves off is always on point.
On point.
Bringing you the best on current issues, community affairs, and the happenings around us. This segment of Gloves Off is brought to you by the best, so pay them a visit. Check them out. This is Gloves Off.